Yes, so my name is Simon Kågström, and I work at NetInsight. And I have a few colleagues here, as well as a few former colleagues. I develop embedded software, and tonight I will present Kcov. Maybe I should call it Kakov. I haven't thought very much about the pronunciation, but I will present it today, which is a code coverage collection and presentation tool for Unix systems. So I'm also happy to see a few Unix beards here. Okay. So I'll start with the end. Yes, sorry, one more thing. If you have any questions, so you can interrupt me meanwhile, because it will probably be more fun that way. I was also going to ask if you are properly caffeinated before, but you're drinking beer, so maybe that's even better. So I'll start with some motivation for some talk, for the talk. And if you look at Wikipedia, then you will see that code coverage, that's the degree to which the source code of a program is executed when a particular test suit executes, measured in percentage. But I was thinking more of, let's say you're a software developer working at some company, and you're developing a library. And it happens to be a library which is widely used, and it's also security critical. Many hundreds of millions of people are depending on it for their salaries and buying stuff and so on. So you're using all the best tools of the trade. You're trying to write good tests and writing in the state-of-art program for secure programming language for secure programs, C. And then you're executing your test suite and you're thinking, yeah, maybe I will take a look at, see how well my tests are actually covering the code. So here we have some output. You have the program, and then you have some red lines, some white lines, and green lines. And the red lines, that's code which hasn't been covered. The white lines, they are non-code, so comments and so on, and some control structures doesn't actually generate any code. And then the green lines are executed code. So, does anyone see anything strange here? So you're reading through your listing here. What about this part? Looks like there's lots of code here, but that one is marked as white. Why doesn't the compiler think this is code? So does anyone recognize the particular piece of code here? Yes? Yes, it's the go to fail bug. So, you know, nowadays all security related bugs should have a good name, and this one just sort of named itself. I guess they all do in some way, but here you have a misleading indentation, and you have a go to fail statement, which is always executed. And then the compiler will know that everything you have here, that will not be, well, that can never be executed because you have a fail label here and you always jump to that. So it will just remove that part of code. So I think in this case it would have been good to run some coverage tests on the code, because if you're looking through the code, then sometimes you will spot problematic things like this. And some more motivation here. I think we programmers should, in general, be humble people. Do you think we are humble people? Some are not, and that really surprises me. Because programming really is hard. We do fail at times, and we shoot ourselves in our feet. I've done it many times myself. I failed with raw pointers and also now with modern C++ shared pointers and so on. Can easily shoot yourself with those as well. Lambdas and using the linker as well, and actually also Java bytecode. I can discuss that later if someone wants, but then I need beer. Yes. I'm impressed. Okay. We'll talk about that later. So anyway, I try to be humble about my abilities. I know I will always fail and do it again and again. So I think this is why we need good tooling and obviously also good methodology. So back in the days, maybe you can write some program and then just release it to your customers and they will test it for you, but it typically doesn't work like that today. You have to have good tests and good tools for it. And code coverage is one such tool that you can use together with sanitizers and good debuggers and so on. So I think that's my motivation at least for this. And I also think it goes very well together with test-driven development and unit testing and so on. So this will be the outline of the rest of the talk. So I will start with a short discussion of code coverage in general and problems with traditional tools, which in this case mostly means Gcov. I'm not familiar with how things work on Windows and not very familiar with Mac OS X either. So in Unix or traditional Unixes, Gcov has been the main tool. Then I will present Kcov or Kågström. Give an overview in general what it does and the main features. It can also integrate with some continuous integration cloud-based systems. Also covers Python and Bash code. And then I will have a small interactive demo. We'll see if we encounter the demo effect here. Then I will discuss how Kcov works. I heard some people here discussing about the design of debuggers before. I will actually touch that because it's a bit related to how Kcov works. And we'll also spend some time on some quirks and bugs which show up in Kcov, especially with the different architectures and systems it runs on. And the last slide, which is perhaps the only one which may be a bit more related to a C++ meeting, discusses the design of Kcov itself, so the sort of source code. It's written in C++, but I'm maybe not the premier expert of C++ here. I know I'm not. So, starting with the overview then. So most of you have probably encountered code coverage collection already, in some form at least. And there are many variants of code coverage of increasing refinement. And you can look them up on Wikipedia as I did. So you have function coverage, which will only tell you if you have executed the functions in the programs, the statements in the program, and then branches, if you have all the ways through if, case statements, and so on. And these are increasingly sophisticated and detailed. So in most settings, this modified condition decision coverage would be the holy grail. But it's also incredibly hard to write tests to actually cover this. And all tools doesn't allow or show if you have fulfilled all these. So does Kcov fulfill the holy grail? No, it doesn't. It's maybe the unholy grail condition coverage it's aiming at. I've also before this talk read up a bit about code coverage or some articles about it, because I've written some tools for it, but I'm not an expert in the area itself. And you can ask yourself, is code coverage some effective tool? Well, the effect on software quality is actually a bit mixed and unclear from the reports I've read, at least. So what that means is that higher coverage percentage doesn't necessarily mean that that it translates into fewer bugs. And interestingly also that the more advanced types of coverage also doesn't have a clear relation to the number of bugs. So from my point of view, I believe that code coverage is probably more or better suited as a development tool, especially when you develop tests and so on, that you see what you are actually, that you are testing, what you are believing what you are testing there. And that's also where I personally use it mostly. So at NetInsight, where I work, we write a lot of unit tests, and in those cases I think it's a very good help. So I will briefly discuss them. You know, if you are selling something, you need to show why your particular product is better than the competitor's product. So I will talk about Kcov and Lkov, which are my competitors. So Kcov has been the traditional way of collecting code coverage on Unix systems. It's shipped with the compiler, so we always have it there. And then Lkov is a presentation tool, so you can get HTML reports from it. Very nice reports, because Kcov itself will just give you or dump the source code on the in the terminal, and it's not very easy to read. But these two together, they are a good match. I think the process of collecting and reporting is a bit cumbersome, because you need to compile with special arguments for the compiler. This you typically don't use when you are building production code. So minus G says that emit debug information, and then warnings, and then the minus minus coverage for Kcov output. Then you run your program. And if you then look in the output directory, you will also see that you have some more files here. I call them droppings, because they pollute the source and build directories. And build directories, of course, you never, that doesn't matter, but the source directory, they typically end up there as well. And then use lkov, and then it's some command line arguments, and generate HTML, and then you're done. There are some other limitations as well with Kcov. If it happens that your program crashes, then you will lose the coverage collection. You can work around that in some ways, but it's still typically you just lose everything. And also, if you have shared libraries, well, then you have to build them as well with coverage and so on. So it's a bit lacking, I would say. We have salespeople at our company. They are great at presenting products and making presentations and so on. So I will say now that fortunately, Kcov, that does away with all these disadvantages. It allows collecting without any special compiler options, and it reports without leaving droppings around. And all this is done with a single tool, single step. So it's a bit of a sales pitch, I think. obviously, we should note here that there are other collection tools as well. Clang is starting to get coverage collection, and I guess there's lots of commercial tools as well, which I don't know very well, which are probably better than Kågström. But anyway, I will go into the usage of Kågström and a bit of history here. So my own personal background into code coverage actually started with Bash, shell scripts, which I wrote another tool for many years ago that collected code coverage and then generated these LCOL style HTML reports. And then almost 10 years ago now, I discovered an interesting tool called Bcov, written by a guy called Thomas Neumann. And I think it was a great idea. I simply forked that and called it Kcov. And Bcov, the main benefit of that one, like with Kcov, is that it doesn't rely on compile time instrumentation, but it uses debug information instead to collect and generate reports. I thought it was a great idea, but I thought it could maybe be improved on because it still had this split between collection and reporting, which I thought you could just merge into one. In hindsight, I probably shouldn't have forked it, but tried to improve on the original project there. But the thing is that it was written in a language called C++. And I had great difficulties understanding the source code there. So I basically took the small parts, or the basic engine from it, and then rewrote it in C. So then I thought that it can't be Bcov anymore, I have to. And actually a few years ago, or a few years later, I rewrote Kcov in C++. So anyway, now we have it. It's a new product and project, and this Thomas Neumann has actually contributed some amounts of code to Kcov as well, so I think it's fine. And can you guess why it's called Kcov, by the way?
Your name?
No. that's a good, good yes.
Kdi?
No, actually, it's. I think you can't. Yeah, no, that was. It's K for kernel. Because what I thought, but okay, they are using breakpoints here. And I was at the time. Working with some kernel code, Linux kernel. And there is something called K-probes in the Linux kernel, which can work like breakpoints. So I thought that, okay, it's a great idea, and maybe you can use it in the same way with K-probes. So therefore I called it Kcov, and thought that I'll just take the sort of user space part in it and then add on the kernel stuff, and it can do both. Unfortunately, the kernel stuff never worked very well. I blame it on the K probes because it simply ended up crashing the kernel instead of collecting anything. And then, confusingly, there is now a kernel Kcov as well, which is not related at all to this Kcov. And my Kcov predates the kernel one. But this one also collects coverage for the kernel, but they use it in another way. They use the coverage information to guide syscall fuzzers, so automated testing tools, you can say, to try to find paths through the kernel and crash the kernel. Of course, I could do that just by using a normal kernel infrastructure, but. Anyway, so there now is a Kcov, but it's not related at all to this. So this is a list of features. As I noted before, then you can build with debug information, as you typically do anyway, then because it's convenient when your program crashes. And as long as you do that, then Kågström has everything it needs for collecting coverage. You can also collect from optimized binaries, but then it will be in the same way as if you debug an optimized binary, that sometimes it results in a bit confusing behavior. It will also automatically detect shared libraries and instrument those, both those that you have linked into the binary compile time and those you open with DLOpen, so dynamic loading of libraries. And then I think the main selling point, so to say, is that there is a single step only. You will collect and report with one single command. And apart from the LCOV-like HTML, it will also generate a set of different XML and JSON formats so that you can integrate it in other environments. And when you run the same binary multiple times, Kågström will accumulate the coverage data as long as the binary hasn't changed. So you can see if you, with one set of options, you maybe pass one way through the code and another set of options, you will pass another or go through another way through the code, and then you will see that it accumulates and it both will be presented. And it also merges the reports from multiple binaries into a combined one, and manually you can also merge multiple actual reports into a single one. And it works on I guess the most used Unix system, so Linux, FreeBSD, and the Mac OS X, and on a few set different architectures. And you can use it with some of the more popular cloud services, and also Jenkins and Sonar Cube is some other sort of local continuous integration system. It can upload directly to the coveralls.io. If you use GitHub and Travis CI, then this is a popular add-on to it. So it's very easy to generate a report and upload it here. That's like a single line. And similar, there is another one, codecov.io, which is basically the same thing as coveralls, but with a different interface. And that one is also, actually, Kågström doesn't know about this one, but Kågström is supported by codecov.io, so that's also very easy to integrate if you use GitHub and Travis. Personally, I don't have a really favorite coverage cloud system, so I use both. And apart from C and C++, you can also collect for Python and Bash. And a difference between C and or compiled languages is that these report the execution count for per line, and C and C++ report if a line has been executed or not. Yeah, so I thought we'd do some interactive demo. Oh, this one. Let's see if I can get rid of this. So I'll need a terminal. Stuck in there. Oh, interesting. Okay, that was some old file I had. Okay, so Kågström is a command line tool. You run it like this. You get a lot of options you can do. But the basic usage of it is run Kågström, you tell it where to put the the output, and then you have the binary which you should run. So I have, for example, Kågström itself, like that. And then you will get coverage output here. So yeah, you can see the binary, and you can see how much of it have been executed, and not very much in this case, but that's also not very strange because it only shows the help. And then you have some covered lines and the number of executable lines. And if you look into it, you will see a list of files. Then you have, you can also sort these in different ways, so by file names and, it's actually implementing the JavaScript stuff, that's not my best area. That took a lot of time. This is stolen from LCOV, but there you cannot change the columns and so on, but it was very tricky to get it working. So yeah, you have that one, and then you can also look into files here. I can see if I can find something more interesting. Yeah, doesn't matter, you can look into any. So here you can see then, like the report I showed before, you have white lines, not executable code, and then you have red lines, which hasn't been executed. And here you can see that you sometimes get confusing results here. C++ generates some code there. I don't know exactly why it does that, and so on. Then you have these yellow lines. And here it says 1 out of 2. And that is that on this particular line there are 2 locations which it has instrumented, and only one of them was executed. Maybe this has to do with exceptions. I don't know well enough, but it typically happens. For what I think it's most useful is to see the red lines. That's what you're normally interested in, because that code isn't coverage at all. So one thing you noticed here was that there is a lot of user include stuff, and you're typically not very interested in those, because yeah, that's for the standard system. I will also show you that this is the output, all droppings end up here, doesn't pollute what it shouldn't. So just removing it, then everything will be gone. But I will also show you that you can filter the output, because you are typically only interested in some parts of the code. So you have a few different sets of filtering you can do, and what I typically do is to use the include pattern. Good. So you can see here that all projects Kcov, that's where the interesting stuff is. User include, that I don't want. So I will see that all the paths that contain projects Kcov should be included. Do the same thing. And then you will see here that it excluded all the user include stuff. And also the dot 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 stuff is that all files here have a common path at the beginning, so it will just abbreviate that. Okay, I will just briefly show you that it will also merge reports. So I have some unit tests for it as well. Very few unit tests actually, so maybe I shouldn't show you this. Okay, so I ran Kcov on the unit tests, and then I will reload this one. Then you see you have another one, UT, which are the unit tests. But also you have the merged report here. And that is the combination of this one and that one. So there are a few more covered lines, because there are some that are covered only in the first one and some that are covered only in the second one. So if you look at that one, you will get a merged report, which has information from both of them. I believe that was the demo.
You're merging these reports from the two different binaries, where the same source code has been used.
Yes.
How does it detect that it's the same source for
it? Yeah, it hashes the file name and the contents of the source files. Of course, I said before that you can also collect from Python and Bash, and you can get some silly reports where you merge Python and C code and so on. but in general, it works like that. It will hash the contents and the file name. Well, we'll do like this. How does it work? Yes, so.
Before you go into that, what's the performance over there?
I was expecting that question as well. I will also discuss that. I will just shortly tell you how it works. So Kågström basically works like a debugger. So it does actually run the program. It just, you start the program with Kågström before it will fork and then execute it. And Kågström works like a debugger. It uses breakpoints to instrument the binaries. So I will just shortly discuss some of the technologies used by Kågström. So binaries in Linux and many other Unix systems, they are stored in the ELF binary format. And this goes for both the binaries, shared libraries, and the object files which you link together. And this one basically contains code, data constants, and relocation information, debug information, and so on. And then the second one, I'm not sure how it's spelled out, no, pronounced. I see it as macho, but I don't know. That's the binary format used on OS X. I don't know that in any detail, but it performs basically the same things as ELF does. And then, dwarf, obviously. That's a format for debug information. For Kågström, the most important thing is that it contains the mapping between source lines and addresses. But for debuggers, you also have information like type information or variables and so on. So there's a lot of things which is not interesting for Kågström, but which Dwarf itself contains. So you can see that there are a lot of funny names in this area. So stabs, that's another, an older binary format, which I guess is not used very much today. But yeah, they are funny people that develop these things. So, Kågström relies on the dwarf debug information to set a breakpoint on each executable line in the program. And the debug information contains records of file and line to address mappings, which is exactly what Kågström needs. So you have some disassembly here, some instructions to the right, and then the instruction encoding in the middle. And you can see the red ones here. That could be basically the dwarf entries. You have an address, this is the source line, and yeah, the address to the instructions here. So that's what the dwarf contains. And basically, Kågström starts the program in a stopped state, sets all breakpoints for all the lines in the program. It parses the dwarf data, and then lets the program continue again. And on each executed breakpoint, each time it stops on a breakpoint, it will mark this line as this file and line pair as executed. And then it will remove the breakpoint and let the program continue again. And you asked about performance. Does this sound like a very slow process? I think there are two ways of answering that. You have the sort of salesperson. If I'm the salesperson, I'll say, no, it's very quick, doesn't affect your performance at all. And then you have the engineer, which will tell you that it's horribly slow. It's very, very, very slow. So we'll see. I can run these unit tests. Yeah, that was without Kågström. That was with Kågström. Yeah, oh, that's a factor of 10. Bad result, very, very slow. So the salesperson is wrong. But the important, or the thing here is that since it removes the breakpoint after it has been hit, there is a huge startup cost to it to parse the binary and set all the breakpoints. But after that, then, well, when you have removed the breakpoint, then it will just continue executing the code as before. So, yeah, you have a very big startup cost and then obviously reporting and so on, but the actual execution of the binary is not very much affected. For, I mean, where you have loops and do lots of stuff in those. It will be sluggish at start, and then it will sort of pan out. Yeah, so how do we set breakpoints on Linux and other Unix systems? Well, if you look into a process using or a program using readelf, you will see that it has a lot of sections and some contain code, some contain data, and so on, and they are loaded on an address. So from this, you know where the code in the program is. But that was also in the dwarf information, wasn't it? It contained this file line to address mappings. And typically, you can just use the dwarf information and set the breakpoint at the addresses they have there. But for example, shared libraries, they are loaded at different places. They're compiled to be position independent. So for those, then you will have to relocate it first or figure out where it has been relocated in the running program. So there is some additional stuff to parse. You have to know that this particular section here that is loaded on this address in the final program. So it's a bit more complicated than just using the dwarf info directly there. And using ptrace, it's a pain. it's a very, very ancient interface and also non-portable in many different ways. So I have a very, very short example here on how the code looks. So you have, this is only on Linux. On other, the FreeBSD works in a different way here. So you have this part of the code is for this ARM64. And then you have to do it in a different way on other architectures. So it's very, very non-standardized and difficult to use. But basically, ptrace, what you do with it is, apart from starting and stopping processes you can do with it, but you can also use peek text and poke text to write into the memory of the process. And that's how you set breakpoints. And setting a breakpoints really just means that you overwrite the instruction with another instruction or a breakpoint instruction. So yeah, that's how you set it up then. And this is how Linux works. I've also ported it to Mac OS X, but that one works in a completely different way because, as I said, they are macho. And there is no, as far as I found at least, no standard library to parse the macho binaries like there is for ELF. So I instead used the LLDB debugger as a library, and that one comes with OS X as long as you have the development environment. Comparing these two implementations, it's the LLDB implementation is much nicer. It's very, very short and easy to use, but it's also much slower than the raw implementation we use for Linux and FreeBSD. Okay, I don't know, am I running out of time here or? Yes?
When you remove the breakpoint, how do you retrieve the original instruction?
Yeah, good question. So, setting the breakpoint, you have to replace it with the breakpoint instruction. So what you do is that you read out the...
So you have your own database or
name? Yeah, it keeps track of on this address you have this instruction. So when you remove it, you write it back again. But I was wondering, are there any interesting bugs affecting Kcov? And yes, with setting breakpoint, there is some interesting quirks there. And one thing is that the generation of the dwarf debug information is sometimes buggy. And then the dwarf info will contain invalid entries. And when you're using a normal debugger, you typically will never see this. But because Kcov sets breakpoints everywhere, you will detect some stuff like that. So we are looking again at the same disassembly as I had before. But this time, the dwarf information looks like this. So you have this breakpoint, like before, line 124, 125. Then it says that the breakpoint should be here. And then the next one was okay. So this one is not good. And this is x86 assembly. And on x86, you overwrite, or a breakpoint instruction is called int3 for some reason. And it's encoded as a CC. So what I would do is to write one byte here. But in the program then, if it comes here and then executes, and then it finds here an instruction which is C743CC and so on, and that will typically be an invalid instruction. It's not the breakpoint because it doesn't start with the breakpoint instruction. So effectively, we have destroyed the program. And basically, two things can happen. Either it's an invalid instruction, or even worse, it's a valid instruction, but it's another instruction, not the one that you built there. So how do we fix that? Do you have any ideas?
Disassembler?
Yes, very good. There is a workaround because this happens surprisingly often. On some systems, I even get it with Kcov itself, so running Kcov on itself will immediately crash due to this one. So basically, it will disassemble the entire program and see then, okay, this dwarf entry, now that points not to the beginning of an instruction, but somewhere else. And then it will just discard it. This is mainly an x86 problem. I don't think any other architecture will have this problem because most others have a fixed instruction length. And even if they would have it, it's much easier to detect it. You don't have to do disassembly. You can just check if the address is aligned or not. Yes?
Is this a bug in the format or in the
it's in the tools.
I don't know.
Actually, I'm not sure. It happens with GCC. Kågström, I think the place where it's used most is with the Rust programming language. And they generate this frequently. You can basically not run any Rust program without detecting this. And they have a bug written on it, but I'm not sure they don't think it's very important. But it could also happen that it doesn't happen with more recent compilers for Kågström itself, so maybe they fixed something in GCC at least.
Do you check that like when you build the program or only if you get the instruction?
It's expensive, so you have to specify a command here. We can see if that one affects performance as well. Verify. Yeah. It's even more expensive. But yeah, it will do that on when you load the program before it starts executing. Yes. And then another bug here. I guess this is turning out to a campfire discussion here. And that is with LLDB, the debugger on OS X, and it comes with LLVM. And that has another interesting quirk, and that is that forks are unsafe when you're running in the debugger. And that's because, as you probably know, then forking in Unix means that you create a new process which is identical to its parent, apart from that it returns to a different place from the fork call. So we have the fork here, you have error in the child or in the parent. So we return to two different places here. But the problem with LLDB is that it doesn't catch the signals from the breakpoints from the child. So if we have a breakpoint set here, which Kågström will always have, then you will crash, or the child will crash. So I have a workaround for that as well. How would you do that? Well, it's sort of, it works around this particular problem, but it's not ideally what I would like to do, because what it does is that it sets a special breakpoint on fork calls itself. And when that one is executed, then it will remove all breakpoints in the program and then set one additional breakpoint on the parent return from fork, and then continue, and then the child will not get covered, but at least you will not crash and you will return at the parent point there. And this is a LLDB bug. It's the same if you use a regular program in the debugger. It will also crash like this if you do it. So it's something for them to improve. GDB doesn't have this. Then you can follow forks and have commands there. I don't think I should talk very much about this. Python and Bash works in a completely different way, but that's pretty obvious, I think. The main tricky thing is that you need to know what is executable and not. And this is easy to do in Python, but very tricky in Bash because you have lots of strange syntactic expressions like this here doc when you do cat and end of file and do a lot of stuff that's easy to get lost in. And well, this is the final. I will just briefly talk about the design. This is the C++ I will cover here. Kågström is written in C++, unfortunately C++ 03. And that's because there are some people that use it they started complaining when I wanted to port it to C++ 11. So it's ancient code. But this is the basic design of it. It uses the observer pattern a lot. So you can recognize the things we've talked about parsing and so on, that you have a file parser interface, which is where the binaries are parsed. And then this one will report file line address mappings and so on. And then you have the execution that's done through an engine here, where you start, stop, and collect, or where you hit breakpoints. But then control is done via this, where do we have it? The collector up here. So that one is controlling the engine telling it to set and remove breakpoints. And then reporting is done via the reporter there. So basically what it allows is that you can implement these interfaces in different ways, and that's how it does with Python and Bash. And that's a different type of engine. Ptrace is one type of engine, and you have the LLDB there. And the same thing with the output, that you have a writer interface and you have different types of writers. And here you can also see that these are actually both engines and the parsers here. Because it's more natural to have it merged in Bash and Python, but it, with binaries, it's not at all the same thing. So that's basically how the design was. I guess for questions, if you have any. Yes?
I'm pretty sure I've seen disassemblies which sometimes get disaligned also with the code, for instance, in libraries where gaps between entry parts. How do you view that? Those are
code. You mean with the source code and the disassembly
one? I'm dreaming, but I'm pretty sure I've seen disaligned disassemblies.
Yeah, I mean, if you build with optimization, then it's natural because But even without it, yeah, maybe it could be related to this. It could be, because I don't know if you have an invalid entry. Is that just 2 bytes off, or is it 1,000 bytes off? Then you will get complete misalignment there. So it could be that. I don't know.
First, I think you want the screen sitting in the code in 6.6, so that can... Have you thought about
including
passing into this?
You mean like the other Kågström does?
American passing loop.
That's one of the things which the kernel Kågström is used by, I guess. I haven't looked into it at all. But I guess. I'm not sure if it has enough information to do with intelligent decisions on how to control it, but yeah.
I was going to ask, what have you got in the pipeline?
there are a lot of bugs which should be fixed, but if you look at the GitHub issue list, it appears that it's most popular to use Bash. Or that the Bash implementation is so buggy because it has a lot of, but I don't like very much working with that. But I've been looking at offline instrumentation as well, so that basically you pass a file system to it, and then it will instrument all the binaries in place, so to say. So you add some data with. This binary has these instructions which you should instrument, and then you have a sort of daemon which will instrument them when they are loaded. But it's not really finished yet. Yes?
I was wondering, do you know how Kcov does it?
Not in detail, I don't know, but. When you compile the program, it will be separated into, you know, the basic blocks, so a straight line, or straight lines of code, so to say, no jumps and so in between. And I believe the Kågström instrumentation uses the edges between the basic blocks, so that when you, well, on each jump between basic blocks, it will put an instrumentation point, so that you, then you know that all statements within the basic block has been executed. But I don't know it in detail. I've also actually tried to implement or to read the Kågström format and produce Kågström output for it. But it's a bit difficult to parse. So I haven't finished with that. And LLVM has a similar thing called, I think, the coverage sanitizer, which produces a very easy format to or output format. But that one is a bit lacking in where it's not easy to know exactly where which lines are covered by it. The LLVM itself will know because it's the compiler, they know all that stuff, but offline it's not very easy.
Interrupt. Professor, when the clock is very late now. Those who want to go to out can already go out, hang around, and answer questions. Thanks, Simon, for this excellent talk.